إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فلا مضل له، ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد في الأولين، اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد في الآخرين، اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد في الملأ الأعلى إلى يوم الدين. My dear respected brothers and sisters in Islam, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. I'm your host, Kareem Abu Zaid, and I'm coming live from Denver, Colorado. Brothers and sisters in Islam, Ramadan is approaching slowly. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us amongst those who live this month in spite of the lockdown and the COVID-19 the way which pleases Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Tonight is the night of the Right Believe series, the virtual Right Believe series, and that's session number 3. A lot of you have insisted that we have to present the Right Belief series regardless. I think you agreed to two classes, the three classes, I'm sorry, the higher aims, the tafsir, which is really related to the Quran, and also the Right Belief series, and Know Your Messenger. Those are the three classes which we will continue, but the way we do it, inshallah, is we engage you in a PowerPoint, very short, for 30 minutes, and after that we open the floor for questions and answers related to the subject of the Right Belief series, or of course the subject, the prime time now is the subject of Ramadan and the fiqh issues related to Ramadan, inshallah. But as I wait for more people to join us on the broadcast, inshallah, let me welcome those who showed up already. Brother Muhammad Musa, he's number one today, mashallah. And wa alaykum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, Brother Muhammad. We have Sister Yara. Jazakallahu khairan, Sister Yara. She is saying in Arabic, shukran, thank you for the beneficial programs. Jazakallahu khairan. We have Al-Nur Firko, wa alaykum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Saddiq Hakim Rashid, Rashad, I'm sorry, wa alaykum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. We have Fazma Ibrahim. وعليكم السلام ورحمة الله وبركاته. فياز رومي وعليكم السلام ورحمة الله وبركاته. خالد محمد وعليكم السلام ورحمة الله وبركاته. صفت مشخولي. هو I'm saying your name right. وعليكم السلام ورحمة الله وبركاته. Our local brother حسين دين الإسلام. He calls himself that. وعليكم السلام ورحمة الله وبركاته. How are you, brother حسين؟ نظيمة شمس الدين وعليكم السلام ورحمة الله وبركاته. Our own أبا أذان brother إسماعيل وعليكم السلام ورحمة الله وبركاته. عرفان is it our عرفان local عرفان وعليكم السلام ورحمة الله وبركاته. Our dear sister آمنة شانلي وعليكم السلام ورحمة الله وبركاته. We made dua for you sister آمنة last night and we make dua for you again today, mashallah, and I really want to say, mashallah, a lot of you have considered helping Colorado Muslims Community Center with giving us donations. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala increase your wealth. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless your health. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala keep you safe and protected, all of you, you and your families. We have a big organization here, and we do have a lot of people who rely on their income from that organization, teachers and people who teach Quran, and Alhamdulillah, Jazakumullahu khairan for your support. I understand that a lot of you may not be able to. We realize that because of the COVID-19, but those who are able, inshallah, your wealth will never be wasted, because Allah will give it back to you, inshallah. We have our own local brother Shu'aib. Wa alaykum salam, brother Shu'aib. Yes, I agree with brother Ismail. Please post your questions after the opening, after I present my PowerPoint. Ismail, okay, we have sister Umm Muhammad. Wa alaykum salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, sister Muhammad. Our sister Umm Adhan, wa alaykum salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Sister in Islam, wa alaykum salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Abakar Muhammad, wa alaykum salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Muwani Ibrahim, wa alaykum salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Sayyida Hassan, wa alaykum salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. We have Mustafa Abdullah, wa alaykum salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Sayyida Hassan, again, she said number one. I don't know what there is number one. And Sayyida Hassan, number two, wa alaykum salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Our sister Salwa Abdul Razak, wa alaykum salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, dear sister Salwa. Amina Yusuf, wa alaykum salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Muhammad Juda, wa alaykum salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Kaboom, wa alaykum salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. RR5, wa alaykum salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Anyola Abu Nwanda, wa alaykum salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Ahad Hakim, wa alaykum salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Anu, welcome back, Anu, we haven't seen you in a while. Hussein Almi, wa alaykum salam wa barakatuh. Antonio Gini, that sounds like Italian to me. How are you doing, Antonio? Wa alaykum salam wa barakatuh. Ziyat, wa alaykum salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Oh, from Kuwait. So Antonio Gini from Kuwait. Are you Italian? MashaAllah. Okay, Hamza Free, wa alaykum salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Lotus, wa alaykum salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Abdu Abigiru, wa alaykum salam wa barakatuh. Sister Rahima Taylor, wa alaykum salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Okay, Arfan from UK, not our local Arfan. Okay, wa alaykum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Tariq Abdul Wahid, wa alaykum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Al-Hayar Tarkhil, wa alaykum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Well, we're going to come to the question and answer, inshallah. Hopefully, we have time to talk about Ya'juj and Ma'juj today. The straight path, wa alaykum assalam wa barakatuh. Hassan Ali, wa alaykum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Okay, brothers, mashallah, we have a lot of people on the broadcast tonight. Mashallah, we're very busy tonight. I always do the first 30 names. So if you're late, that's your business. Okay, okay, are you ready? But before I go there, please, a couple of announcements before I go. A very important event tomorrow, 12 noon, myself and Sheikh Asim al-Hakim, all the way from Saudi Arabia. We will answer your questions related to how to maximize your Ramadan this year in spite of the COVID-19 lockdown. And the fiqhi issues related to that subject. Like how to pray and how to lead the family and who should lead and all of this, inshallah. Again, another reminder, I have to remind you, we have the Venmo, the Cash App, ourcmcc.org, that's our, meaning mine and yours and his and hers. It's our CMCC, and CMCC stands for Colorado Muslims Community Center, and it is .org. We are a 501c3, by the way, if you wish to receive donation receipts, we can do that for you, absolutely, inshallah. We have also Muwahid and PayPal right here. So those are the advertisement or the announcement we want to have. Of course, we started that COVID-19 initiative relief fund. Alhamdulillah, wallahi, ikhwa, we just received a couple of applications already for people who wants help. And alhamdulillah, may Allah reward you. A lot of you have given. We have actually some funds that we can disperse already to the families who are affected by the COVID-19, and they, you know, they want to buy groceries and all this stuff, inshallah. طيب, let's get to business. I want to make this quickly, inshallah. Brothers and sisters in Islam, shirk in Allah's lordship. The study of Tawheed cannot be completed without studying its opposite, shirk. We will look in depth into this subject, because there are serious consequences if a person falls into shirk. Sufficiently, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَغْفِرُ أَن يُشْرَكَ بِهِ وَيَغْفِرُ مَا دُونَ ذَلِكَ لِمَن يَشَاءُ. This is the verse right here in Surah An-Nisa 448. Surely Allah will not forgive the association of partners with him, but he will forgive all other sins. That's how serious shirk is. And that is why you have to take it seriously, brothers and sisters in Islam. But the point I was trying to make is, sometimes, subhanAllah, things can be understood through knowing the opposite of it. Like white can be distinguished when you see black. You're getting that. So subhanAllah, sometimes teaching shirk and what shirk is and what makes a Muslim falls into shirk is actually a way to believe in Tawheed. And you need to understand this. This is the methodology of the kalima, la ilaha. So you're supposed to know la ilaha first. So you're supposed to know what will nullify la ilaha illa Allah, your tawheed. Illa Allah is the actual tawheed, except Allah. So when we say shirk, ولذلك يا إخوة, just to show you how Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu an was extremely well grounded in the knowledge of this religion. When this verse was revealed today, I completed the religion for you. The famous verse in Surah Al-Ma'idah, meaning the Prophet completed his message. You know what Umar commented by saying, anything that is complete must start declining. It will start declining. And he mentioned why. Why? Because there will come generations who are born into a pure monotheism and they have no knowledge of shirk. Not believing in shirk, but no knowledge of the practices of shirk. And what can take a person into shirk? He's saying, because we experience shirk and we knew what shirk is, we knew that we cannot step there. But there will come generations who don't understand what makes a person falls into shirk, and he will fall into shirk. طيب, that's what we're going to do today. Let's review quickly, inshallah. We mentioned the belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala comprises the following. You believe Allah exists, they believe in His lordship, they believe in His names and attributes, they believe in His rights upon you, which is the uluhiyya or the worship. So when I say al-imanu billah, you come up with those four. You believe, number one, that He exists. He exists. Why do you need that? Because there are people who say God doesn't exist. We call those what? Atheists. So you need to prove to them that Allah exists. Now, you believe in His lordship. in his names and attributes and his worship. Those are four areas. Once it comes, so if you're asked, what does it mean to believe in Allah? You mention those four right there. طيب. We're reviewing. Remember, when you call an atheist to Islam, is different to calling someone from the people of the book. When you call an atheist to Islam, you need to focus on Allah's existence. You need to focus on that part. Because he doesn't believe Allah exists. But when you talk to a Christian or a Jew, people of the book, about Islam, you focus more on the subject of the names and the attributes of Allah. And this is why a lot of our da'wah is not working. Because a lot of Muslims do not master that field. Because quite frankly, it's a very tricky. If you don't know how to sail, you will get in trouble. Because talking about Allah, about his names and attributes, there is a certain methodology to do that. For a lot of people, because they don't master it, then they don't talk about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Look at the third thing here. Stay away from the Sharia side of the religion when you talk to those. It's a wrong way of da'wah, 100%. When the Prophet sent Mu'adh to Yemen, he said to him, start with La ilaha illallah. If they accept it, then talk to them about the salah, about the zakah, and so forth. Don't go and say, no, I can't drink, no. And Aisha mentioned what? The first things which we knew from the Quran, who is Allah? Huh? Does it, that he exists? Names and attributes, lordship and actions, his worship. And what do you get if you do that? Jannah. And how Jannah is? What's in Jannah? And what will happen to you if you don't? Hell. And what's in hell? You're getting that. That's all. And of course, character is missing as well, and that's a problem once it comes to da'wah. We're reviewing all of this. How to prove Allah's existence? Five evidences in front of you right here. Your fitrah, I always like to say Islam inside, the aql, the intellect, the sharia, the religion, the manuscript. When you follow the Quran and the Sunnah, you become a decent person. Supplications. A lot of times we make supplications and Allah accepts it. And we knew of prophets having miracles. We reviewed all of this before, so this is like the belief in Allah, like we said. That's, we kind of mentioned that before. Two or three types of tawheed, we kind of address that. Here's the thing. To believe that in Allah's lordship, because today we want to talk about shirk in that area. So you single out Allah as the Lord in four areas, four major areas. Look at these colored, blue, yellow, green, and red. These are the four areas. The creator, the sovereign, the owner, al-mulk. He created and he owns. He takes care of it. The nourisher, al-mutasarrif, and the one who rules, the one who tells you what to do with it. Ala lahu al-khalqu wal-amru. Four areas. And there are sub to these. First, he created. He owns it. He did not create it and leave it to you. La, he still owns it. And he takes care of it. He provides. And he tells you what to do with it. This is the lordship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this area. Now, let me jump, because my time is running up here, to the area where, how do you violate that area? What is shirk? That's the message of today. Shirk literally means partnership. In your own own business, if you have a business, if you don't have enough money, what do you need? You need a partner. If you don't have enough knowledge, what do you need? You need a partner. Experience in the field. You have money, but you don't have experience, so you need a partner. You have the money and you have the experience, but you're not well connected in the system. So you need somebody who can navigate the bribery and the payoff people and how it's done these days, unfortunately. So does Allah need any of this? Huh? Does Allah need any of this? That's exactly what shirk is. That's what shirk is. Shirk is associates, partnership. Allah doesn't need that. So, polytheism in the Lordship is to believe that others beside Allah creates or share control over His creation. This belief means that someone other than Allah can make good things happen and keep bad things from happening. That's very dangerous. And I'm telling you, brothers and sisters in Islam, this is the area they mess up our children. We grow up in a culture, Mother Nature, the snow. A word that Mother Nature. Oh, energy creates itself. Oh, I'm afraid of COVID-19. COVID-19 is going to kill me. COVID-19, you know, when you need to understand this. Nothing happens in the face of this earth unless Allah wills it to happen. Look at this. Allahu khaliqu kulli shay. Allah is the one who created every little thing. Wa huwa ala kulli shay'in wakeel. And He is the wakil. What is wakil? He placed something inside it that He has to command it to work. Otherwise, it's not going to work. And we have examples. What are the physics of the fire to burn? How come it didn't burn Ibrahim? That's why you need to focus on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's the area. One example of this type of shirk is to believe something brings good luck. People often have good luck rings or similar items they believe will help good things happen to them. Other tie special strings around them or their children, necklaces, hijab, believing that if they recite Quran over the strings, they will be protected, as if these things function in their own. Look at this, brothers and sisters in Islam. I love this last bullet. Please, please read it. Only Allah can protect us from bad things. And only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala may get good things. And the only way for us to get this protection through the ways that He mentioned in the Quran and in the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So if you want to be protected, if you want Allah to protect you, follow the means. Dua, salah, istighfar, the means, or even the material means. But the ring or the hijab or the number 5, the handle by the door, I don't know, every culture developed its own set of superstitions, and they think these things can help them beside Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Moving forward, I still have, I think, 7 more minutes, inshallah, and I'll be done. Don't be bored. I love this subject of Tawheed, brothers. There are 2 subcategories once it comes to shirk in Allah's Lordship. 2 areas. Number 1 is the most awful of them all, that you cancel out the existence of God, which is shirk by negation, in the area of what? That you say there is no God. And those are the atheists. or Fir'aun or Namrud. They did that. Only few people, by the way, they run this in history, because you really have to be a wacko. You have to be crazy. Because your fitra will not accept that. It's very difficult. But the most difficult type which a lot of Muslims fall into is shirk by association. Yes, they believe in Allah. He believes that they create. But yet they still do stuff which reflect that they believe these things which they do can benefit and can protect them from harm. So let's go over this quickly, inshallah. So the first type is the negation, to deny the existence of God, either explicitly or implicitly. Like ideologies out there, atheism or pantheism, even though they say there is no God, and but yet they believe God, good luck charm. You see, I read today that fortune is a name of a God according to the Greek culture. You know, fortune, it was a name of a God, good fortune, my fortune. Or Mother Nature, saying Mother Nature, even though they are atheists, but yet they refer to some powers in earth which cause things to happen. But yet they deny the existence of God. But yet they say nature. So what is nature? What is nature, God? Well, I'm sorry, let me educate you, because nature is created. That's the first type that you negate Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Buddhism, actually, a lot of you may be surprised. Buddhism, read that slide right here. Buddhism, brothers and sisters in Islam, is a religion. And that is why a lot of the brothers, when we tell them, yeah, don't do this yoga stuff and don't yoga yourself, because these are practices of what? Of people who deny the existence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Buddhists. And again, Ikhwa, this is academia. This is where we're explaining that stuff. In no way that we're inciting hate towards any of these groups. We live in a world where we don't do that anymore. But we're explaining, that they commit shirk. They actually negate the existence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Another example, the Firu. You know, that's an obvious example. He was really out of his mind, simply. But let's move to the other type, which is the most dangerous type, in the 4 minutes I still have. Shirk by association is the belief that a main God or a supreme being is recognized over creation, though his dominion is shared by other lesser gods, spirits, mortals, heavenly bodies, earthly objects. Those beliefs are commonly referred to by the theologians and philosophers as monotheistic. So they refer to it as monotheistic, and that's the deceiving part, but yet it's polytheistic, because they actually associate. Let's investigate some examples for you. Let's look into some examples. Are you ready? That's the last piece we're going to have, inshallah. We're almost done. Okay, the Arabs, polytheists, Mushrik al-Arab. The Arabs at the time of the Prophet ﷺ, they were not atheists like some people now. If you ask them who created the heavens and the earth, they will say Allah. If you ask them who created you, he will say Allah. They believe that. You know what they negate? What they negated? They believed, number one, I'm not saying it's good, that's terrible. But they believe that Allah is the creator. Allah is the nourishers. But they believe that you cannot go directly to Allah. You need a medium, intermediary, someone in between, the gods, the idols, which they made up. And who does this now? Muslims. He goes to the grave and he calls upon someone who is dead beneath the grave in order to bring him closer to Allah. He believes that this person will take him to Allah. It's exactly the same. Or the extreme Sufis, they go to their sheikh. That sheikh will take me to Allah. And of course, they use analogy. They say, listen, if you want to meet a president, don't you have to go through the secretary? Ya akhi, Allah is above that. Don't liken Allah to any time. حسب نفسي عزا أني عبد يلقاني بلا مواعيد ربي. هو في قدسه الأعز وأنا ألقاه متى وكيف أحب. I'm honored by being a slave to Allah, slave to him. He's above me in his glory and I can meet him anytime I want. Anytime I want. Just say Allahu Akbar. Just call upon him anytime. You know, you're not going to be concerned whether he's asleep. Wal'ayadu billah, astaghfirullah. No, anytime. The Arabs, they also believe that he cannot raise us again and so forth. طيب, Hinduism is a famous, look at this slide right here. Within Hinduism, the supreme being, Brahma, and they believe that there are Vishnu and Shiva. So three. So even though there is a supreme, but yet these others are destroyer and preserver. The same concept exactly. Famous Christianity, Father, Son, Holy Ghost. Three. Even though they believe it's one God, but yet he developed again another the Parsis, the Zoroastrians, Ashura, Maza, you know, they have the same exact concept. The concept of three always existed. Extreme Sufis, with all due respect, they believe that there is someone else out there who creates, gives life. Among some Muslims people, Shirk and Rububiyyah is praying to the souls of the righteous people. Even though they were righteous and they could be innocent from this, by the way. Brothers and sisters, Isa alayhi salam is worshipped, but he's innocent. Likewise, a lot of people who are worshipped by ignorant people, but they are innocent. And in the Day of Judgment, Allah always described this scene when they disown those who worship them. إِذْ تَبَرَّأَ الَّذِينَ اتُّبِعُوا مِنَ الَّذِينَ اتَّبَعُوا. They will disown you. I don't know you. Grave worshippers, we talked about that. Al-Qadariya, we have the people who say that we create what we do. When Allah says that I created you and that which you do. Knowledge of the unseen. If you go to a fortune teller, a soothsayer, the horoscopes, other things, the stars, believing in the stars, worshipping jinn, that you go to the jinn. Horoscopes, coffee cups, palm reading, all these things, brothers and sisters in Islam, are things which, subhanallah, takes a person out of the fold of Islam. We're going to stop here. But this is the shirk in Allah's lordship. How? That you negate, you cancel out Allah, like the Pharaoh, like the atheists now of our time, or the people who were brought up in the culture of public school system, and others do it by association. How? So they believe Allah exists, they believe that there is a God, but the Father, the Son, the Holy Ghost, and so forth. Inshallah, let's get to business here. Bi-idhnillahi ta'ala. Let me put the phone number there. Hopefully you guys can see it. The phone number there. Can you see the phone number? It's a little bit in blue out there. 303-500-5101. It's on the top of the screen to the right there. If I can kindly ask somebody to try our Skype. Let me see if I can make this a little bit bigger here. Okay, maybe it will work. Okay, here it is. So that's the phone number right here in blue. Give us a call, inshallah. We welcome to our show. So the Skype is working. Can we get somebody to try our Skype, inshallah, please? Somebody gives us a call. Make sure it is working. Inshallah, we got already a call already. So, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته الشيخ.
جزاك الله خير أزان جعلك الله سباقا للخير. May Allah make you always hasty to do what is good. May Allah reward you.
آمين. السلام.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. You know, one of the things which will happen in the grave is when everybody leaves us behind, if the person was righteous and pious, subhanAllah, your good deed will be turned into a person. And a conversation will take place, so the deceased will ask, who are you? Say, I'm your good deeds. By Allah, I only knew you. Hasty, quick, once it comes to doing good things. You don't hesitate. Sari'u sabiqu. So the phone number is showing in blue up there. And I'm sure we have a lot of people, inshallah, who asked questions already. So let me go through these questions. Bi'idhnillahi ta'ala. Let me just go through them one by one. Okay, I have to scroll back here. Assalamu alaikum. Okay, I don't want to skip anybody, so I'm trying to go back. MashaAllah, you guys posted a lot of questions. All right, let me see here. Come on. Okay, the first brother here is asking about Ya'juj and Ma'juj. Inshallah, I will. Let me see. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Assalamu alaikum.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, brother.
Wa alaikum assalam. Alhamdulillah, how are you doing?
I'm good, brother. I'm calling from Pennsylvania.
Yes, sister.
Brother, my question is after Fard Salah, what are the etiquettes? What are we supposed to do? I know we are supposed to make zikr, but I have seen some people immediately after Salah, they make dua. What is right? What are the etiquettes? Can you please explain?
Jazakallahu khairan. So our sister from Pennsylvania, she's asking regarding the sunnah. I wouldn't say etiquettes. I would say sunnah concluding the salah. So after saying assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah, there is an established sunnah that a person should engage in the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala individually with the dua astaghfirullah, astaghfirullah, astaghfirullah. Allahumma anta as-salamu wa minka as-salamu tabarakta ya dhal jalali wal ikram. Allahumma la mani'a lima a'tayta wa la mu'tiya lima mana'ta wa la yanfa'u dhal jaddi minka al-jadd. And la ilaha illallah, and then you recite ayatul kursi and qul huwallahu ahad, qul a'udhu bi rabbil falaq, qul a'udhu bi rabbin nas. Then you make dua and you could raise your hand yourself. Now subhanallah, I think Sufyan al-Thawri says any time that you introduce a bid'ah, it will eat up a sunnah, it will replace a sunnah. Because listen, the Prophet did not leave a minute, but he given you what to do. He kept you busy already. So just look for what he said. When you introduce something, you're going to eat it. So this is the sunnah. So what people do, the imam raises, Allahumma gfir lana, in congregation. And that never established. That never established. Jazakallahu khairan, dear sister, inshallah. The straight path is asking regarding, okay, the question, okay, I guess that's really is not a question. Okay, Sayyida Hassan, I have a couple of questions. If a sister due to a certain medication that has a side effect of a regular menses cycle, see spotting, what should she do? A lot of sisters experience this, brothers and sisters in Islam, and we always go back to her period. When is your period? Does it take place? So taking medication sometimes may cause some spotting, but what these sisters have to be vigilant about is when does her period normally happens or takes place. And that is when she count the days of her regular. But during these times where there is spotting, we say, wait until the adhan is called. You could fast, of course, talking about fasting, you could fast. But once it comes to Salah, wait until the time of the Salah gets in. The time is here. Adhan is called. Make wudu. Pray with that wudu all the nawafil and the mandatory, inshallah. Barakallah fiqh. Okay. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. السلام عليكم.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
وعليكم السلام ورحمة الله.
This is Fatima calling from Maryland.
Sister Fatima, go ahead, inshallah.
Yeah. If you miss Fajr and you woke up, can you pray the Sunnah before praying? Can you pray the Farad before praying the Sunnah?
جزاك الله خيرا, Sister Fatima. بارك الله فيك. So Sister Fatima is saying, if you missed Fajr and you woke up late, what should be the protocol? First of all, if the sun already risen, that should be the protocol according to Hadith Bilal, which is authentic. One day the Prophet ﷺ and his companions, they were overnighting in a place, and he asked Bilal to wake up everybody in order to observe Salatul Fajr. Subhanallah, Bilal missed the time. And Rasulullah, imagine, he moved out of that place, even though the time is already, because he saw the sun is already up there. He moved out. He asked Bilal to call the Adhan, make Iqama, pray the Sunnah. Adhan, pray the Sunnah, make Iqama. So he followed the protocol of Salatul Fajr, because you already missed the time. So you should observe the two rak'ahs first. Then you follow it with the Sunnatul Fajr, which the Prophet ﷺ said about it. Rak'atayul Fajri, the two nafila before Fajr, khayrun min ad-dunya wa ma fiha, is better than this world and everything within this world. But let's say that you woke up and 5 minutes left for Salah, for Fajr, for the sunrise. 5 minutes. Then go ahead and begin with the mandatory. Begin with the mandatory, inshallah. And even if you make up the nafila later, that's okay, bi-idhnillahi ta'ala. طيب, let me see here what I have. Brother Mukhtar, may Allah preserve millions of Muslims, non-Muslims to the right. Ameen ya Rabbil Alameen, he's making dua, Brother Mukhtar. What are your thoughts on saying Jumu'ah Mubarakah on Friday? Sister Sayyida Hassan is asking regarding people saying Jumu'ah Mubarakah. 100% bid'ah, has no place whatsoever in the Sunnah. Where do you get that from? Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, Sheikh.
Alhamdulillah, sister.
I am Umma Iman Naeem. I am Umma Naeem from Colorado again.
Sister Umma, how are you doing?
Hello.
How are you, sister?
Alhamdulillah.
How is your family?
Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen.
Go ahead, sister. Yes.
Behind the Imam, silent prayer. So he's like he reciting silently, so can I say any like Surah Al-Fatiha and then short Surah repeatedly, still he say Allahu Akbar and then Ruku, and
Jazakallah.
Is that permissible?
I will answer you.
And yes. I have another question.
Okay.
I have another question.
Okay, let me
can answer. Can you give me some?
Okay, let me answer this. Let me answer this question quickly. So.
Okay.
Our local sister is asking regarding praying behind the Imam and the issue of reciting Al-Fatiha. We know that there is I have a 12-13 minute video on YouTube. I would love for you, I done a lot of research on this, and I produced a 13 minute video reciting Al-Fatiha behind the Imam and so forth. But I want to give you just the piece that you're asking for the sake of time. The correct opinion, if the Salah is silent, that you should recite Al-Fatiha yourself behind the Imam, and Quran as well. And Quran as well. The subject here, if the Imam recites, can you recite or not? That's the only thing, inshallah, that is bending. What is your second question, sister?
Yeah, can you give me some tips how to have a khushu when I am praying? Because sometimes distracting when I'm praying. Do you have any tips on that? I see
hadith al-Nabi. So the sister is asking regarding some tips to develop khushu' in your salah. We all get distracted, wallahi, it's not only you, sisters. And a lot of the, Ibn Abbas actually is the one who said that. It's a sign of having tawheed in your heart. But in general, my dear respected brothers and sisters in Islam, I love hadith al-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, اذكر الموتى عند صلاتك. Remember death when you're about to pray. Imagine this salah is your last salah. What will you do? And I don't know if you have good access or good search engine with Google, good experience, but maybe somebody can help you. I recommended the work of Sheikh Muhammad Salih al-Munajjid. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to free him, Ya Rabb al-Alameen, and protect this Sheikh, Ya Rabb al-Alameen. He has 33 ways to have khushu' in salah in English and in Arabic. And I think some other people did some translation in other languages. Go and look for it. He compiled every little tip which someone may need to develop khushu' in the salah, inshallah. Jazakallahu khairan, dear sister. Assalamu alaikum. Stay safe.
Wa alaikum assalam.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Alright. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. This is Fatima again.
Yes, sis.
If a female is praying by herself in a room with nobody in there, can they recite the Quran or the Fatiha loudly that they can hear themselves, or it still have to be quiet?
They can recite with a low tone that they hear themselves. That's okay. As long as they are by themselves in the house.
By
that's
themselves,
fine.
Yes.
Yes, that's okay. Fine, inshallah. Good. Jazakallah khairan, sister Fatima.
Okay, fine.
Salamu alaykum wa barakatuh. So, what are your thoughts on Jum'ah Mubarakah Bid'ah? I'm sorry, I'm harsh here, but it's a Bid'ah. 100%. There is no question about it. طيب. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
السلام عليكم شيخ كريم.
وعليكم السلام ورحمة الله وبركاته.
This is Ahmed Atta from California.
Oh, brother Ahmed.
Yeah, brother Ahmed. Yeah.
How are you, Ahmed?
Can you Alhamdulillah, how's everything?
Alhamdulillah.
You know, somebody asked me a question today. I told him I'll ask you. The hadith that says about Each day you fast for the seeking the reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that will take you 70 years away from the fire. Is it a correct hadith? And if so, can you shed some light on that?
Yeah, the hadith you're referring to, Ahmad, is narrated in Mustadrak al-Hakim, and it is authentic according to Sheikh al-Albani, I believe. He authenticated it and others. Hadith Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As radiyallahu anhuma. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam says that whoever fasts one day fi sabilillah, man sama yawman fi sabilillah, ba'ada Allahu bayna wajhihi wa bayna an-nari bihadha al-yawmi 70 kharifa. So this day will be like a protection from the hellfire. The distance which would take you to travel for 7 years, meaning it will distance you from hell. And you can add to this hadith, الصوم جنة. The صوم, fasting, will be a protection from hell. Because it's not physical, but because of the act, it will keep you away from falling into hell, inshallah. Jazakallah khair, brother Ahmad. Ahsan Allahu ilayk. Assalamu alaikum.
Jazakallah khair.
Waalaikum. SA is asking, inshallah, I want to let you know today, inshallah, we will go until 9:15. In the weekends, I will, Friday, Saturday, we'll go until 9:15, inshallah. because supposedly you're not working tomorrow. I'm sure I'm talking to other people who are across the globe as well. But inshallah, we'll go tonight until 9:15. So go ahead and ask your questions. Hopefully, you see the number on the screen in blue, 303-500-5101. So here is the question we have from SA. To listen to a khutbah during the time of Jumu'ah, is it okay during that time? Quite frankly, I don't recommend it. Because now the question, can we pray behind this imam? And the virtual Jumu'ah came in and all that stuff. Brothers and sisters in Islam, we have an excuse not to observe Jumu'ah. Stay at home, pray with your family. Have a little meeting with your family if you want. But, you know, you're really virtual, and especially, I don't know, I'm, you know, listen, what we're experiencing now is unprecedented. You know, it never happened. We never had this before, and a lot of people are doing ijtihad. And we ask Allah to guide all of us, yani. And based on their intention, they get a reward, actually. But you going to the masjid and standing on the pulpit and empty masjid and giving the khutbah, what the hell is there? Why are you doing that? I mean, I don't get it. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Yes, name, state, and question, please.
My name is Mukhtar. I'm calling from Raleigh, North Carolina.
Yes, Mukhtar, how are you doing?
Alhamdulillah, my question is about inheritance.
Okay.
I'm saying if a man dies and he leaves three wives and he leaves some property and some form of income for his family, and one of the wives passed away after the man had passed away. Now, if there's anything to share among his immediate family, does the wife who passed away after the man had passed away, does she have any share, like, you know, give, you know, her share to her own family or, like, you know, her own sons or daughters from the man? Does she deserve
anything? So who Mukhtar, who passed away first, the husband or the wife?
The husband passed away first.
So the wife inherits the husband.
The husband passed away first, then
the husband had three wives. Just go with me, Mukhtar.
Yes.
So the wife inherited her husband, yes. Then she died. Her inheritance, yes, is to be distributed amongst her immediate children.
Yes.
Jazakallah khair, Mukhtar. Barakallah fi. Okay. We have here, can you give some information on the preservation of the Quran? Thanks, Sheikh. Forgive me if I am not. That's a very good subject. I'd love to talk about it. But you know what? I will, inshallah, address it. Bidnillahi ta'ala, but not today. Inshallah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Assalamu alaikum. Yes, name, state, and question, please. Yes.
My name is Zainab. I am 12 and I'm from Maryland.
Yes, Zainab, how are you?
My name is Zainab. I have a question.
Okay, go ahead. Go ahead.
If you are oppressed in public, like if someone pulls your hijab, and do you have every right to defend yourself and make a scene, or are we obligated to walk away?
So our little sister, may Allah protect you, if you're wearing the hijab and somebody happens to attack you, can you defend yourself 100%? Self-defense is Allah is giving right even in other cultures, in cultures that are not religious. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, whoever dies defending himself, من مات دون أهله وماله فهو شهيد. So defend yourself, inshallah. But you have to assess the situation, Zainab. whether you engaging in self-defense will bring more harm on you or not. If you can defend yourself and stand your ground and so forth, do it. But if it's going to bring more harm upon you, then walk out is much better. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Caller, assalamu alaikum. Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam.
Yes, your life. Go ahead, inshallah. Your name and question.
My name is Asim, and I'm calling from Australia. I just have a question regarding the 15th of Shaban, because lots of people say that you actually need to do some special ibadah and, you know, read a few special surahs in that particular night. Now, is there a basis? Is it true or is it not?
I'm sorry, my dear brother from Australia. What is your name again?
My name is Asad.
Asad. Asad, we have a state here in the United States. It's called Missouri. In their license plate, they have a very interesting slogan. They say, show me state. Show me evidence. You know, we read a lot of things about the 15th of Sha'ban. Look at the experts of the ahadith. None of it is authenticated. The only thing we know that we should strive to free ourselves from shirk or from injustices which we infringe upon others or commit against others or having grudges towards other Muslims. And that's the only way Allah will give you forgiveness. Other than that, if you're used to worshipping Allah every night, if you're used to praying tahajjud every night and you pray tahajjud on the 15th, that's fine. If you're used to fasting the 13th, the 14th, the 15th, and go ahead. If the 15th falls on a Monday or Thursday, go ahead. But initiating an act of worship because of the 15th, never been established, Brother Asad. And send my salams to the brothers in Australia. May Allah protect you and keep you safe, dear brother. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Assalamu alaikum. Assalamu alaikum. Okay. Assalamu alaikum. Okay. I guess Antonio is telling me he's from Albania. Assalamu alaikum. That's the Sheikh's place. May Allah protect you, Antonio. Okay. Muhammad Akram is watching all the way from Sri Lanka. May Allah reward you, brother Muhammad Akram. Okay, let me answer this. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Assalamu
alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam. Okay. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Assalamu
alaikum. Wa alaikum wa rahmatullah.
Yes. Name, state, and question, please.
Walid from New York.
Walid, how are you, brother Walid?
In regards, hafazakallah, ya Sheikh. May God preserve you for us.
I mean, how is the situation in New York, brother Walid? We hear, you know, a lot of,
wallahi, the situation. I happen to actually work in healthcare myself. It's very bad, but it's qadr Allah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect all the Muslims and give shifa.
Ameen.
To everybody that's sick.
Ameen, Ya Rab. Ameen, Ya Rab al-Alamin. May Allah protect you, brothers. May Allah protect you. May Allah keep you safe.
Ameen.
Ya Rab al-Alamin. Yes, yes.
I have a question in regards to zakat.
Yes, Walid, go ahead.
My question is, now, for the zakat on gold.
The zakat on what?
Can you give me the rulings on
the zakah on what, Walid?
On gold.
On gold, yeah. Gold, which is used for hulay, ornament, or for investment?
No, it's for ornament, but it's, I can tell you, it's never, I say maybe worn once every 4 or 5 years.
Right. Okay. I'll answer you, brother Walid. Brothers and sisters in Islam, brother Walid from New York, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to please make dua for the brothers and the sisters in New York. They are really experiencing it. May Allah protect them, Ya Rabbil Alameen. He's asking regarding Zakatul Huli. I cannot answer this question before that subhanallah, the opinion of the three imams, Malik, Ahmad, and Shafi'i, they say as long as you're not using it for investment, then it is not zakatable. But subhanallah, the opinion of Abi Hanifa rahimahullah is the correct opinion, even though it is one against three, in a friendly sense. Yani. Why? Because the three imams, Waleed, they used what we call ta'lil. What is ta'lil? Yani reasoning. That, well, it's not for investment, then it's for ornament and... but the scholars, they say at-ta'lilu fi makan ad-dalili 'alil. You know, when you use ta'lil, when there is an evidence, the ta'lil is sick, meaning it's not good, it's not healthy. It's not a good healthy practice to do that. Abi Hanifa, when he ruled, he used hadith fi sunan Abi Dawud regarding the mother who brought her daughter to visit the Prophet ﷺ, or ask the Prophet a question. And the Prophet saw that she was wearing a huge bracelet. So he asked her, أَتُؤَدِّينَ زَكَاتَ هَذِهِ? Do you pay zakah on this? She said, no. The Prophet said to her, you're going to be given one from fire if you don't do that. So Abi Hanifa said that the Prophet did not ask her, are you using it for ornament or for investment? So regardless. Of course, some of you may ask why the imams did not, because this hadith did not get to them. Would they have known about this hadith, they would have ruled like Abi Hanif. And that's how we look at the imams in a respectful way. But of course, we have to bear in mind that the gold has to reach the nisab, which is the minimum 85 grams of gold. And you own it for a whole year. And you do it every year. Some of you may have just heard this ruling tonight, and you've been owning gold for years and you have not. Just go ahead and perform it one time now for the previous, because you did not know, and now every year you have to weigh and assess how much it is in the market, and then go ahead and pay your zakah on it. Jazakallahu khairan, Brother Waleed.
Wa'iyak, brother Abu Zaid. But I have a second part to the question, okay. If I have time.
Yes, go ahead, inshallah.
Okay, so let's say the breadwinner of the home is the husband, and he suggests to pay the zakat on that gold for the wife, and they both agree on it. Is it allowable?
Yeah. Or yeah, 100%, yeah.
The owner of the gold.
Yes, 100%, yes. The husband can help his wife pay the zakah on her jewelry, yes, inshallah. Otherwise, she's going to sell it out by the time, inshallah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi
wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Okay, let me go through some questions here. We have... can you guide me how to remove magic from me and my family? Wallahi, sisters, wallahi, one of the most trying things, evil eye and magic on a Muslim. Why? But I tell you, Allah wants you to be back. Allah wants you to be closer to Him. Because the only way this will go away from you is if you turn back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in worship, in sincerity. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.
Assalamu alaikum. I'm 9 years old and my name is Mohammed. I'm from Maryland. I have a question.
Yes, Mohammed, go ahead.
How old am I supposed to be fasting?
Are you 9 years old, Mohammed?
Yes.
If your father sees or your mother sees that you're able, or both of them see that you're able to fast, you can go ahead and fast some days this year, inshallah, bi-idhnillah, okay? Normally they say the age of 7, but you have to be physically fit, and the fast cannot harm your body. And the only one who can make that judgment, your parents, and I call upon the parents, and I encourage them to encourage their children to fast. And this is a good service to the children, because you're getting them used to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That approach of compassion and mercy, you know, later on in a couple of years, Muhammad could be already the age of puberty, and then he's going to have to fast, and he did not train. And Rubayya bint Mu'awwidh radiallahu anha said, كَمَا فِي صَحِيحِ Bukhari, regarding the fasting of Ashura, that we used to fast, and we used to train our children to fast. So it is doable. I want to go back to my sister regarding magic and all of this. Wallahi, my dear sister, the only one who can lift this from you is Allah. Don't forget about jinn, be forget about all that. And the means. What are the means? Number one, keep up with the salah regardless. 5 times and have khushu. Keep up with the adhkar. Keep up with the ruqya. And something about magic or evil eye, it doesn't get taken away from you. You have to spend time, maybe 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 months. And being consistent, Allah will take care of you, inshallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and dua, and ruqya, inshallah. I guess Antonio again, he came to learn Arabic in Kuwait. May Allah, inshallah. You can just go out and walk, Antonio, you know, to the brothers here. Was the Ottoman Empire Sunni or Muslim or Sufism? You know, passing a judgment, general judgment, not everybody. I think that's a subject that we should research, inshallah. Mr. Hassan Ali, assalamu alaikum, I'm from Somalia. What is the Somalia? What is the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Okay, brothers, I'm going to have to stop the sky because I only have 10 minutes left. With your permission, inshallah. So this way I can answer the brothers on the chat. We value these brothers. Was it a sunnah for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to take a nap every day in Ramadan? I don't know, but the Prophet used to take naps, but every day, I don't know, quite frankly. So the answer is, I don't know. From brother, Assalamu alaikum from New York, Hamza Free, Nazra Rahman, wa alaikum salam, dear sister, Faisal al-Rahman Bati, okay. Does a woman has to make up the fast she missed when she did not know the fasting is obligation on her? She reached puberty, but she knew. Brothers and sisters in Islam, if you know, we know that there are a lot of brothers and sisters who did not fast while they qualify to fast, or they are, the conditions are there for them to fast. What should they do? Now they made tawbah, alhamdulillah. That by itself is enough. That you made tawbah and now you're going to start fasting your regular Ramadan, and you're not going to skip any anymore. You're not going to be, lazy and negligent of Allah's command. Alhamdulillah, you made tawbah. And the way to make tawbah is you actually begin fasting. What about the previous days? If you know their numbers, it's better to make them up. If you don't, fast as many voluntary as possible in order to hopefully make it up. But the tawbah in itself, brothers and sisters in Islam, should free you from the previous sins. Shukutu wa alaykum as-salam. Jazakallahu khayran. May Allah love you for loving me for his sake. As-salamu alaykum all my brothers. Adam, mashallah. Farid Askar, wa alaykum as-salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Zizubu, Mahdi, as-salamu alaykum. Rahima Taylor, no, I don't know what is no. Assalamu alaikum, Iman Imran Ibrahim, wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi, Fuad Umar, wa alaikum assalam. Sheikh Go SC, what is Go SC? What is that? Go SC, I hope that is for me. Please make dua for me. We ask Allah to protect you, Rabbil Alameen, to get married. You're 37 years old. Fuad, come on, man. We have a lot of sisters, inshallah, waiting for you. Ya Sheikh, what do you know about Nahawaidi laws? Nahawaidi laws, and can you share some of your thoughts surrounding this subject? Noah Haidi, maybe the way that I'm reading it is wrong. Please give me some more explanation. وعليكم السلام. Are you male or female, please? Who are you asking here? He's a male. Okay. They are getting married already. All right. Be nice now. Sheikh, I love the topic. Is shirk and bid'ah. Wallahi, is the most common violation in the deen. Yes, I agree. And knowledge. Muhammad bin Umar, assalamu alaikum, Sheikh, wa alaikum salam. I live in Canada. Brother Fuad is already. This is the best topic that we need more time. Aba Hamza, wa alaikum salam. Assalamu alaikum, Sister Rahima. They say Catholics, they believe you pray to the saints. Yeah, exactly. Like the extreme Sufis we have in the Muslim world. You agree? Watching from Kashmir, India. May Allah, your lectures are full of knowledge. Jazakallahu khairan. Robot, I know that's a nickname. May Allah protect you. May Allah free our brothers in India and Kashmir, Ya Rabbil Alameen, from the oppression. Mahad Faisal, watching from Malaysia. Wa alaykum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Yara Muhammad, I will ask my question from yesterday if it is okay for those pregnant nurses. Okay, I promise to answer you. And I was planning to answer you tomorrow, wallahi, Sister Yara. But let me, if you allow me, that's the last question I'm going to take. I know I still have a lot of those. Allahu Akbar, I'm going through the list. Wallahi, you guys are not going to be mad at me now. I think I've given more interest to the people over the phone, and I neglected my brothers. Please forgive me, inshallah. But this is, I still have two more minutes. Brothers and sisters in Islam, regarding sisters who are pregnant or breastfeeding, and what should they do regarding making up the days in case if they break their fast? This subject is connected to another subject, which is, what is the ruling on birth control? I'm going to ask you here, what is the ruling in birth control in Islam? I know this is out of the blues here. Actually, birth control, or preventing pregnancy, basically, is allowed in three cases. Of course, the breastfeeding, وَالْوَالِدَاتِ يُرْضِعْنَ أَوْلَادَهُنَّ حَوْلَيْنِ كَامِلًا, the 2 years of breastfeeding. And if there is immediate and present danger on the health of the mother, like sisters who deliver through C-section, they tell you that you have three, four, five, sometimes six pregnancies. After that, you can't be pregnant anymore. So that's the ruling. So now we have two sisters. A sister who has a baby, and maybe after 3-4 years, another baby, khalas, I gotta keep up my figure. And let's not blame the sisters, or the brother is already, afraid, more children, more responsibility, no, I can't handle this. So they go for birth control. We tell this sister, you have to make up the days. But let's look at a sister who wanna stick to the deen now. Alhamdulillah, every year, whether she's pregnant or she's breastfeeding. So imagine now if she ends up with 10 children. That means every 3 years, she's going to have a child. That means she's going to miss 3 Ramadans. Let's assume that she broke fast those 3 Ramadans. So each child now is 90 days. 90 times 10 children, let's go for 10. Is what? 900 days. She has to make up. And remember, she's pregnant, she's breastfeeding, she's pregnant again, she's breastfeeding. And bear in mind that she's already what? She's approaching the 45 and 50 and maybe up. That is why the ruling out there for this sisters is to feed for each day. And that's the correct opinion, and this is the adopted opinion by Ibn Abbas, Ibn Umar, and Sheikh Al-Albani promoted this, inshallah. Jazakum Allah khaira. I want to apologize to the brothers and the sisters who I did not get time to. But remember, tomorrow, brothers and sisters in Islam, we have this beautiful meeting with Sheikh Asim. Let me get you the flyer right here. Tomorrow, 12 noon, 1 o'clock Central, 2 o'clock Eastern, 11 a.m., Pacific time. Please join us, inshallah. Please, if you find it in yourself to help our community, we're really desperately needing help. If you're able to, please help us out. This is the way to do it, inshallah. I love you all for the sake of Allah. Please don't forget to subscribe to my YouTube channel, Kareem Abu Zaid, Facebook page. I'm sorry. A lot of you go to the Facebook page and they don't do like. You know, that's the only way you're going to find out. And remember, brothers, we wanted you to send us your opinion. And I'm going to ask our admins to actually work this out about what is the suitable time in Ramadan to broadcast. Obviously, 8 o'clock for me is not going to be easy because I have to lead my family in Taraweeh. So please, kindly, brothers and sisters in Islam, if you can, if I can ask the admins to... And the only platform we can use this is the Facebook, inshallah. Also, don't forget to subscribe to our YouTube channel, Imam Kareem Abu Zaid, and the other channel, The Straight Path. This is a backup, inshallah, bi-inillahi ta'ala. And inshallah, very soon we're coming up with an app, and all my lectures will be available on my kareemabuzaid.com. So if YouTube messes up with us again, we have that platform, inshallah. And I believe there is a brother who's working on an app that you actually can download on your phone and watch us live and watch the lectures, inshallah. Whatever I said right today is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and whatever I said wrong is from myself and shaitan, and I ask Allah to forgive me. I love you all for the sake of Allah, and I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless you and protect you and keep you safe and make us all come out of this trial and tribulation safe and sound, ya Rabbil Alameen. With more iman, with more faith, with more yaqeen in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, wanting to do more for Islam, wanting to help Muslims, wanting to be better Muslims, ya Rabbil Alameen. Jazakum Allahu khaira. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.